Hello everyone, in this video we will look into the 8086 coprocessor configuration and the closely coupled configuration for 8086. First we will see the coprocessor configuration. So coprocessor configuration, it is one of the multiprocessor configuration mode for 8086. So 8086 is a very powerful processor in those days, but it was not sufficient to perform various complex processing for different applications. So we cannot have all the functionalities. So for that we need to have some other process which can be supplementing the 8086, like the coprocessors. So for example, 8086 do not support floating point operations. So to perform floating point operations, we can use 8087 numeric coprocessor, which is capable of doing various floating point operations. So this is the typical configuration for a coprocessor or closely coupled configuration, wherein the 8086 is the main processor or the host, and we have the additional processor which could be either the coprocessor or the independent processor. So in this configuration we will have the coprocessor. So what it indicates is it shares the same clock and also the same bus control logic and shares the memory and I/O space for coprocessor. So for the coprocessor configuration, no additional logic is required. Only thing is the maximum mode operation it should support. So the program written for this coprocessor configuration is a normal 8086 program with additional instructions for the coprocessor. So wherein it will have the superset of 8086 instruction set, which will also include the coprocessor instructions. So what happens is an instruction will be fetched by the 8086. If it is for the 8086, it will execute it. So if the instruction is for the coprocessor, the host 8086 only fetches it, the instruction, and whereas it will be executed only by the coprocessor. So this is the synchronization diagram between the 8086 and the coprocessor. So 8086, it will check whenever the escape sequence has been made. So it just wakes up the coprocessor. So in the meantime, the coprocessor also monitors the instruction fetched by the 8086. But it will not execute any instruction meant for 8086. So it monitors. So whenever escape sequence has come, it wakes up the coprocessor, and 8086 can execute if any other instruction is meant for 8086 without using the address or data bus. So if it is going to be any instruction with respect to only the register, it can parallelly go on. After the waking up the coprocessor, so in the meantime, it will monitor the 8086 for any instructions, and when the instruction is for the coprocessor, it deactivates the host test pin, indicating that it is executing the specified operation in its coprocessor mode. So once the operation is complete, what it does is it activates the test pin so that the 8086 knows that it has to start with its original operation using the address and data bus. So after activating the test pin, the coprocessor again goes into the monitor mode, waiting for any other instruction to be executed in the coprocessor. So what happens is 8086 executes the instructions. If any coprocessor instruction comes, it will wake up the coprocessor, and the coprocessor will execute it, and after completion it will indicate to the 8086 to resume its normal operation. So the machine code formats for escape instruction. So if you see, after the escape instruction, the coprocessor is getting activated. So the memory operand, if used, so the instruction will have 2 bytes. In the first byte, 11011, the most significant 5 bits, indicates it is an instruction for the coprocessor. And in the second byte, so first instruction, you have 3 more bits. And in the second byte, we have 3 bits. So totally 6 bits, which indicates 2 power 6, 64 operands sorry, different operations can be performed using the opcode. Then for the memory operand, if there are any displacement to be indicated, the other bytes can be used for indicating the displacement for the memory operation. Then if it is no memory operation to be performed, in which case the first byte will have 11011 and 3 bits for the external opcode, whereas the second byte will have 11 and 12345 6 bits for the external opcode, totally 3 plus 6 9 bits for the opcode. So 2 power 9 we have 512 different combinations for the external opcode for the coprocessor. So this for the, if a memory operand, we have 3 plus 3 6. If it is going to be no memory operand, we have 3 plus 6 9 bits for the external opcode for coprocessor. So this indicates a typical coprocessor configuration wherein the clock is shared by the 8086 and the coprocessor. So we have taken 8087 numeric coprocessor connected to the 8086. So it shares the clock and also the test signal which is being asserted whenever the coprocessor is used, and it monitors the queue status. So why it monitors the queue status, we'll see later. And also these are the address and data lines which are shared by the coprocessor along with the 8086. So it is also possible to have two coprocessors connected to the same CPU. As I said earlier, the CPU status lines S2 to S0 and the AD15 to AD0 are monitored by the coprocessor. So 8086 also supports instruction queue. So what happens is the coprocessor also monitors the queue status lines QS1 and QS0. So based on these lines, if the queue status is 00, it does nothing. If the queue status is 01, it checks the 5 most significant bits of the first byte in queue. So we have seen in the escape sequence, the first 5 bits 11011 indicates that instruction is for coprocessor. So whenever an instruction is prefetched in the instruction queue, the coprocessor also monitors to check if it is for the coprocessor. So whenever there is a match, it gets ready to execute the coprocessor operation. If it is 10, the queue is flush. If 11, then actually 11 is for the second byte. So the first byte in queue is not the first byte of the instruction. So what happens is, whenever the instruction is prefetched, if the first 5 bits represent 11011, then the coprocessor gets ready for its operation. So the summary for the coprocessor: the need for coprocessor is, not all processing can be done by the host 8086 processor. So for specialized needs, we might go in for coprocessor. It shares the clock, memory and IO space. And then we have seen the synchronization between 8086 and coprocessor using the escape mode and the test signals. We have seen the different machine code formats and the queue status. So next we will see the closely coupled configuration. So closely coupled configuration, it is also one of the modes for multiprocessor configuration of 8086. So here in the closely coupled configuration, it supports an independent external processor which will have its own instruction set which is independent of 8086. So that independent processor will be tied to 8086 and it shares the same clock and bus control logic similar to the coprocessor. So it is called closely coupled because it is sharing these clock and bus control logic. So instead of escape and wait in the coprocessor, for the closely coupled configuration, the communication with the host 8086 with the independent processor is through shared memory space. So in the shared memory space, what happens is the host sets up message. So it sets up the message and then wakes up the independent processor. Now the host and processor can execute in parallel as long as they do not use the address and data bus together. Okay. So in the message, it indicates what is the type of operation to be performed, what are the input parameters, and where to store the result. Those information have been conveyed by the host processor 8086 to the independent processor. So once the control is taken by the 8086 or the independent processor, the bus sharing is done using the request and grant signal lines. So after completion of task, the independent processor intimates the host using a status bit or interrupt request. So if it is going to be a status bit, the 8086 checks up whether the operation is completed, else it checks up the interrupt set by the independent processor. So this is how the interprocessor communication through shared memory. So 8086 sets up the message and then it wakes up the independent processor using an out instruction. After this, the independent processor, so it will wait for the request from the 8086. Once a request has been made using the out instruction, it fetches the message, it performs the assigned task, and after completion, it indicates the 8086, indicating that the task is complete, and then it will keep on waiting for the next request. So in the meantime, 8086 can execute the 8086 program sequence. So once the interrupt is made after completion of that, then it will proceed with the normal operation. So here what happens is the 8086 program sequence is different with a different 8086 programming, assembly programming. Whereas the independent processor, it will have its own programming language and with different instruction sets. So in the closely coupled configuration, the independent processor requests the bus using the request, bus request and grant line. So when one processor uses the bus, the other processor should not use. So what happens is it forces its status and address and data lines to high impedance state. So high impedance states, it's almost like virtually disconnected state. So the out instruction is used to wake up the independent processor, as we have seen in the figure. So if you take this example, so this is an 8086 in a closely coupled configuration. So this 8086 is connected to the independent 8089 independent processor. So it shares the clock and also the address and data lines. Okay. So this is a configuration involving both the coprocessor and an independent processor. So this is the 8086 host processor. This 8087 is a numeric coprocessor and 8089 is an independent processor. So both the coprocessor and the independent processor can be connected together in a system along with 8086. So all these processors share the same clock and also share the same address and data lines. So if you see here, the request and grant, say whether it is for the independent processor or for the 8087 numeric processor, they have the request and grant lines for taking control over the address and data bus. So different requests and grant signals are used by the 8086 for communicating with the coprocessor and also with the independent processor. Here it uses request grant 1, whereas here it uses request grant 0. So the summary for closely coupled configuration is independent processor is used. Of course, it uses shared clock memory and I/O, and uses shared memory space for exchanging messages. Okay, here again the bus request and grant are done, and then the out instruction is used to wake up the independent processor. Thank you.